Oh, I didn't see you there. I was binging Netflix. Again. 皆さんこんにちは、KemushiChan のロレッタです。Welcome back to another fun corner of reviewing Netflix and everything I have been binging from Netflix Japan while I haven't been editing videos and posting for you guys. Japan has been going through a series of state of emergency pseudo-lockdown things, and with all this extra time at home, I have been using this time to study my Japanese through Netflix. I am a huge fan of finding new ways to jazz up your language studies, and Netflix Japan specifically has been a really cool way to infuse my studies with new, interesting, shiny, crazy, scary words, vocabulary, but actually useful Japanese. So today I am back with round two? I think this is two, maybe three. I'm back with another round of favorite shows that will help you enjoy your Japanese studies and enjoy something new to watch at the same time too.日本の皆さん、最近見てますか？結構、なんか最近結構英語っていうか海外向けのコンテンツがめっちゃ多くて、あんまりもうなんか見る価値ないなっていうふうに思ってたんだけど、なんか今日はあのネットフリックス、私の最近気に入ったネットフリックスを紹介するから、別になんていうの、国問わず誰でも楽しく見れるやつなんで、今日は一緒にレビューをしましょう。Number one, the first one is actually pretty recent. It came out with a huge buzz, a huge bang. If you have been watching any of Netflix Japan, you've probably already seen it. 今はの国のアリス Alice in Borderland. For you anime lovers out there, you probably are already familiar with the anime, but this is the Netflix-produced original live-action series that premiered back in December 2020. When this series premiered, the actual train cars, if you ever got off in Shibuya Station, the underground passages in Shibuya and all over the station were just decked out with posters of Alice in Borderland. Fantasy, thriller, horror, battle royale meets Alice in Wonderland.In a parallel universe over Shibuya Station. The entirety of Tokyo is transformed into VR game space, anything from Shibuya all the way out to Odaiba and everywhere in between. And the different neighborhoods are like live game spaces where you literally, it's like live or die level craziness. When you watch the pilot episode, it starts kind of like, kind of very anime-ish, very cute, you know, family kind of dynamic issues, best friends over family type of dynamics. And then they're running through Shibuya and, you know, it's like three guys are texting each other and you see their text up on the screen. It's like, oh wow, I can read this Japanese. I can learn this Japanese. I was so excited when I saw the first 30 minutes or so and I immediately ran to Twitter and I was like, guys, this is, you guys liked Erased? You need to check Alice in Borderland. This is so cool. I was completely like...I don't know, it was like magic fell over Shibuya all over again. And honestly, one of the coolest things is that I have never seen Shibuya look so empty. Like, I'm very curious about how they produced this show, whether it was actually shot live or if it was kind of like a CGI type of thing. But it's like all of your favorite places in Tokyo, all your favorite stores, everything you recognize, but completely empty. And it's so weird because everyone knows like Shibuya Scramble. Everyone knows...that intersection, but it's literally like poof, gone. Nothing's there. The series centers around the main character who's played by Kento Yamazaki. You guys actually may know him from the live action version of Death Note. Leave your reviews in the comments below. You probably recognize him as well as Heartthrob and their other friend, but three friends who are just trying to figure out what happened to the world that they know it. And it gets really crazy, really fast. It escalates,real quickly, and pretty much by the time you get to episode three, you will be screaming. I'm not even joking. I literally was like, oh my god, no, no! There are a total of eight episodes, but like from episode three to eight, I literally was like this, like the entire day. I was like, no, no, no! I would give 10 points for action, for thrill, for excitement. It's literally like you will scream. In terms of the actual Japanese, you're going to see a lot of really interesting casual, young guy, and even young girl. There's a lot of like very casual young people type of talk around places that you already know in Tokyo. So that's really cool. Once it hits the fan, you're going to start seeing some kind of crazy Japanese that maybe isn't so realistic, like the more anime side of it, but I still think it's really enjoyable. I will say this, very true to the whole Alice in Wonderland theme of things, if you watch this entire series from the beginning to the end, you are going to know your way around a deck of cards. Like, you are going to know how to talk about a deck of cards in Japanese, and you're gonna have your poker face ready because this is just like, Whoa. To be honest, I'm not even sure if you're going to be able to concentrate on the Japanese as much just because it is that visually and story-wise, it is just that, like, jarring. If you are intermediate N3 level and you are really feeling you're not getting anywhere and you're frustrated and you're pissed off, watch Alice in Borderland. It'll get you crazy excited about Japanese all over again, even if you can barely look at it. One disclaimer I have to say, if you do not like gore, if your normal everyday is already pretty stressful, then you probably like watching this is only going to make you more stressful. It is already renewed for season 2. Like, I feel like I have to watch it just to get it through, but I was like, ooh, wow, that was a lot. So you asked me to talk about more dark shows, about more dramas and like good dark dramas from Japan. And honestly, if you're looking for that, this is your show. Alice in Borderland is your show. If you're okay with a little bit of violence, the actual like production level of it, you can tell this was made by Netflix. You can tell like a lot of like really cool stuff went into making this, and that made it so exciting for me. But if you're looking for that sort of like same good quality of production and good Japanese minus the nerves and the anxiety and the horror, maybe watching Erased is better. I've mentioned this in my first Netflix review, and I hands down still think the live action of Erased was one of the best produced movie-ish-esque Netflix series that I've ever seen come out of Japan. For the faint of heart, watch Erased. For the crazy people out there, go ahead and watch Alice in Borderland. Number 2. Tamio, or Wise and Foolish. In a nutshell, think of it as Freaky Friday meets Dr. X. If you've seen Dr. X, you're already used to this sort of genre of Japanese people make fun of the workforce, or Japanese people make fun of serious work situations. It's basically like this, only in this case, it's actually the prime minister and his son who just can't seem to get a job. And this is not a spoiler, this is the premise of the show. What happens is they do a whole Freaky Friday switch, and the son now becomes the prime minister at random. They can't really control it. And the father, even though he's the prime minister and he thinks he's like hot, you know, cookies. He thinks he's hot cookies. He is now a college kid who just can't get through a job interview. This show is basically like business Japanese or N2 Japanese, real useful Japanese with a sense of humor. Everything you ever wanted to learn to do well in school or a job in Japan, but you're gonna do so laughing. The two main characters, the son character is Masaki Suda, who is actually pretty famous if you've ever been into Kamen Rider. If you've seen any commercial recently in Japan, you'll recognize this guy's face. I was not actually expecting anything from him as an actor just because I normally don't like young actors from Japan, but he was actually really, really good. The elderly prime minister in a young guy's body, but you have to still be convinced that it's the original guy. Like, you have to actually believe that the switch happened, and he pulled it off so well. And in the show, they switch back and forth over and over again, and you really know when he is which character. Like, feel like he really has like the method acting down. Like, he really is in character when he's in either one of the characters. The other character, the dad figure, when he's fully the dad figure, is one of my all-time favorite actors, Endo Kenichi, and he's actually why I found this show. I'm really picky with Japanese shows and Japanese Netflix specifically, so usually what I do is I follow one specific actor that I like and like watch everything they've ever done. So I was really into Abe Hiroshi for like, I still am. But recently I'm really into Endo Kenichi. He used to do a lot of like Yakuza and really rough films, but now that he's like, you know, enjoying the rest, like the tail end of his career, you can tell he's really enjoying doing these like goofy, kind of like, I don't know, like Robin Williams, Billy Crystal. Like he's not trying to be snazzy. He's not trying to be like whatever. He's just having a good time and he's so good at it. He was Ebina Sensei in Dr. X. Change and the challenge. We saw his face on like the cover in the Netflix and he does not disappoint. So Endo Kenichi, Masaki Suda together, they are an amazing combination. This is a perfect Saturday afternoon binge and or watch. Disclaimer, it's going to seem really goofy at first, but that's intentional. The more you watch, you start to realize like this slapstick guffaw humor, it's just rich and they really milk it and you're going to have so much fun. And the Japanese that you're actually going to be learning between your guffaws is what you're going to need to pass your interview. If you have settai, if you ever have to do like sales meetings for work. Like I said, N2 with a sense of humor.
N2 with a sense of humor. That's a lie.
They make those?
They make those.
Number 3.
お父さんと呼ばせて。
Nope, not お父さん。 お父さん。 Call me, or no, let me call you father-in-law. This is another one of those shows that I followed down the grapevine of following Endokenichi. This is a kind of affluent family that lives out in kind of like Futako Tamagawa near the Rakuten area. IT tech CEO figurehead character is the dad. The daughter is like another mini IT person. She's a systems engineer. The son is a salaryman. He's like first year at the job. The mom, she's got her own wiles and her own sets of things. It starts with a family dynamic where they're all trying to keep up appearances, but the more and more you watch, you realize how personally dysfunctional each one of them is. But the actual premise of the show is that the let me call you father-in-law, oh gosh, so the daughter, the systems engineer, the tech queen, as we shall call her, it becomes engaged to her boyfriend, who is Endokenichi. They have a gap of like 30 some years or something like that. Basically, he is the exact same age as her dad, and he actually knows her dad, and they have like conflicting business values and business styles, but basically it's like she finally brings her boyfriend home and they're like, oh, we're so excited to meet you, and they're completely appalled that it's this older guy, and he basically is just like, let me call you otousan, otousan to yobasute, and he's like, zettai dame da yo, mittomenai, papa, papa mo dame, papang, papang demo nai. It's this hilarious back and forth of they're just trying to be like a cool, hip family, but no matter what, they're like, their lifestyle choices keep making them like awkwardly, clumsily normal, and it's just like, but great that way. The show in and of itself is hilarious. It's a great laugh, but it gets even better when they introduce the grandfather figure, who's played by Toru Shinagawa. He's actually kind of like a veteran actor in the Japanese scene, but he is not putting up with any of their facade. Like the dad's like, you know, we're a functional family. We all got good degrees, and this is not how we're supposed to be. But the grandpa walks in and he's like, are you serious? Cut the crap. You guys are ridiculous. And he's the only one who actually sees each and every one of them for who they are. He's kind of like the mediator between the two dads, and the dynamic is just, it's hilarious. In terms of the Japanese, like I said, you're going to see a lot of IT words. You're going to see a lot of office, boss, work dynamic words. You're going to see university level college student words. And you're also going to see some real family interpersonal other issues. It does touch on LGBT issues, and it does touch on like women's roles. It touches on some deeper issues than you probably would expect to see from a comedy. If you're looking for real talk, useful talk, and end to, again, with a sense of humor, this show, Let Me Call You Father-in-Law, Otousan to yobasute, is another great show for you. So those are my three most memorable watches, I would say, in the last 6 months or so. I have a whole nother set of favorites that I really liked that I'll share with you next time, where I followed my usual Abe Hiroshi track and started finding some really goofy, deep, oh my gosh, I wasn't ready, oh my heart, my soul type of shows. Thermae Romae, it's not a show, it's a movie. A guy from Rome likes to go to like the public bath, falls through some weird magic portal in the public bath, and falls into a Japanese hot springs, like an onsen. Look at the hot springs. Basically tries to take it back to old time Rome and reinvent all of the like modern amenities of a Japanese hot spring. This is another one of those like slapstick, unapologetically goofy, really good watches. So if you're feeling kind of like eh, and you just want to like feel a boost, watch Thermae Romae, but only the first one. Yeah, and they actually shot it like in Italy. So again, we got like good budget, funny sets, great characters, and unapologetically good humor. Two more in my honorable mentions. I told you that I would watch Tsuribaka Nishi all the way through, and I did. I finally finished it. If you were ever to recommend like good Japanese cinema to somebody outside of Japan, this is the series that I would show you, your mom, your dad, your friends. Hide your kids, hide your wife, because I'm coming with that good cinema. Like really, Tsuribaka Nishi is not only is it a good humor, it's relatable. It's like a guy who just cannot be asked to stay in the office. He's always running and like ripping open his shirt like Superman, but it's a fishing suit underneath. But by watching this series, you are going to impress your friends in Japan. This is the show that you tell your landlady or your senpai or your boss or whoever it is. This is the show that you tell them that you watch when you want to show that like, oh, I'm actually learning something now. Suzuki Kensetsu, Suzuki
Kensetsu.
I've had some like awkward, strange first ice-breaking relationships in Japan, and I promise you, tsuriba kanishi, that is one of the quickest ways to like break past that awkward barrier. So if you're looking to break past it, I highly recommend you give it a watch. So anyways, this is just part one of my Netflix series. I have a whole nother batch for part two, and one that is a little bit controversial. We'll talk about it next time. I think next one will probably be like the Netflix shows I really didn't like from Netflix Japan. See you in part two of the Netflix series. 日本の皆さん、今日もご視聴ありがとうございました。ずっと英語だったのに、英語のレッスンとしては良かったでしょ。これからもちゃんと日本語字幕もつけますので、今後ともよろしくお願いします。See you next time. Stay well, and I'll see you next time. Bye!